individuals serving as the Keystone individuals in their group and really driving the phenotype at the group level. So I'm really excited to see what he has to say today, and I hope the spiders aren't too scary for everybody. Uh-huh. Welcome.
Thanks. Thanks very much for the introduction, Liz, and thanks very much for having me. I feel I should say that since I was a graduate student, I always sort of fantasized about the notion of giving a talk at SFI. So thanks for having me. Hopefully, I will not. Embarrass myself now. And so let's see. So I suppose this first slide gives it away. I study social spiders, and it's the fact that these animals can create natural wonders that originally inspired me to study them. And I will hope to convince you of the coolness of this system today. So pretty much all of ecology and evolutionary biology is to some degree preoccupied with diversity. And so maybe you're one of these people that studies alternative mating tactics inside of a population of, say, these lizards here, which have territorial males or non-territorial males or sneaker males. Or maybe you're a population biologist and you're interested in what allows different subpopulations to maintain independent evolutionary trajectories in the face of gene flow. Or maybe you're a community ecologist or an ecosystem ecologist and you're interested in these biodiversity hotspots like neotropical rainforests or Indo-Pacific reefs, where thousands or tens of thousands of species co-occur on finite resources in an area and in spite of competition. And so sort of the counterpoint to all of those questions today, and the thing that I'll be focusing on myself, is what are the consequences of all that functional diversity? So why do we care about a phenotypically diverse population of lizards, situation, or ecological context? And what that actually means is, well, why don't we put it this way? How many of you have ever had a dog raise your hand, or have seen a dog, or know what a dog is? Yes, thanks for all the hands that are being raised. Thank you so much. All right, so well, let's say you're a real big dachshund enthusiast, and how could you not be, right? Let's say that you allow a female dachshund of yours to produce a litter of dachshunds that you then rear in your home, and over time, you would become familiar with these individual dachshunds. You would get to know their little personality types, and you would tell me about them. You would say some are more active, some are more level. More active individuals move around their environment more, they capture more prey, they grow more quickly, they reach a larger body size, but those same individuals also are more apparent to their predators, and so they're much more likely to get picked off before they ever become reproductive. Small, non-active individuals are, they grow at a slower rate, they don't reach as large of a body size, but they're also much more likely to survive to reproduction. So a growth survivorship trade-off can be contingent on an individual's personality type. In a series of papers by my undergraduates on funnel web spiders, we've looked at the consequences of female aggressiveness. And generally speaking, as a spider, it's good to be a really aggressive female. Why? Because you get a better territory. You get more food, you're more likely to capture more prey, you're more likely to defend your territory from conspecifics that would encroach on it, and so you reach a larger body size. You have more eggs, you have larger egg cases, you effectively win at life. So why aren't all these females wantonly highly aggressive? Well, the problem is that those same females, they get the best territories, they get the most prey, and seem to have the largest body sizes and the most eggs, also suffer from a maladaptively high incidence of precopulatory sexual cannibalism. And what that means is that those same females that appear to have won in all those other contexts end up killing all of their suitors and dying virgin spinster spiders effectively sterilized by their personality type. And that's one of the hallmarks of animal personalities, that you can't just turn it on and off whenever you want. You're stuck with it all the time. And that can beget trade-offs cross-contextually and in contrasting environments. And I study these individual differences and their consequences inside of animal societies. So I address questions like, to what degree do these individual members of these societies, like these ants here, differ in their personality types? Are some of them more active or aggressive or bold or shy or whatever? And then how do the ratios of different types of individuals and the numbers of them add up to create the collective phenotypes of their societies? So just like no two individual animals ever behave in precisely the same way, even among clones, no two collectives ever behave in precisely the same way either. Some groups might have larger territories, they might be more aggressive, they might be more tolerant towards neighbors, et cetera, et cetera. And so I try to figure out how individual level phenotypes combine to create collective phenotypes that differ across societies, and then to what degree that variation across societies influences their performance. And, you know, whenever we think about animal societies, we think about these natural wonders and the great success that they have. And, you know, we're social, and so it can't be all that bad. But, you know, in real life, most of the social groups that are ever founded are gonna die. They're not gonna do so well. Most of them perish before they ever really get off the ground. And even incredibly successful societies that appear to be doing so well can just idiopathically collapse because of parasites or because of intergroup competition or within or infighting, et cetera, et cetera. And so I try to figure out to what degree the collective phenotypes of societies influence their rise and fall. And I study social spiders. Right, so before today, how many of you even knew that social spiders were a thing that occurred on planet Earth? Raise your hand. It's quite a lot of you, probably like 70% of you. But most normal people, not you folks, have no idea that social spiders are even a thing that occurs on planet Earth, right? Because out of about the 55,000 species of described spider that are on Earth now, only about 20, 21, maybe 24, if you get really liberal, are social. So they're kind of an evolutionary novelty item, right? It's not yielded some sort of incredible radiation of species. And unless you find yourself traipsing around lowland East Ecuador, or in Andhra Pradesh, southern India, or in sub-Saharan Africa, you're unlikely to encounter these animals because they mostly occur in the tropics. So most people don't know that spiders could even be social, so we're just gonna do a recap of the kinds of group living that spiders can have. And so there are two kinds of social structures that we'll just briefly go over today, colonial spiders on the left and social spiders on the right. Colonial spiders are a little more common than social spiders. There may be about 300 or 400 different species that can live in colonies, and they form these aggregations of silk. But if you look within this dense aggregation here, each of these little subwebs is actually occupied by only one female, and she maintains that territory from intrusion by conspecifics. So should another female, say, encroach on her territory, aggressive interactions are a result, and oftentimes females are chased away, or occasionally they're killed. So there's very few affiliative interactions, although there are some agonistic interactions inside these societies. Social spiders are a different sort of game here. So there's far fewer species, they're non-territorial, and this is a picture of Stegodyphus sarracenorum from Andhra Pradesh, southern India, and inside of each of these little fist-sized nests here are between 50 and 2,000 spiders, basically cuddling on top of each other. They're non-territorial, so they move around between these different nests, and they don't maintain a little sub-territory within a nest either, and they cooperate in a variety of tasks. And so, social spiders 101. So all the spiders we're going to talk about today are female spiders, and that's for a couple of reasons. One, male social spiders, they don't really do a whole lot. Once they mature, they basically just mate with a bunch of females and then die. In a small number of species, they disperse across colonies, and they are effectively vectors for ejaculate. And then secondarily, females are actually the movers and shakers, right? But then also, the vast majority of individuals are females inside of these societies. So there are 9 to 10 times as many females as males. And that's not because the males die during development. If you allow males to fertilize female eggs and you crush the embryos immediately and count the chromosomes, there are 9 to 10 times as many female embryos as male embryos. Right? And these females cooperate in a variety of tasks. They make a giant web together, they capture prey together like a pride of lions. So although the social spiders themselves are only like maybe 5 millimeters to maybe a centimeter long, they can subdue morpho butterflies or lubber grasshoppers, small vertebrates like sunbirds or bats. We find rat carcasses inside of their societies, et cetera, et cetera. And then lastly, what they do is they engage in suicidal alloparental care. So they'll capture prey for their young. Like any spider, they subdue it. Then they vomit up the contents of their stomach, and they engage in external digestion. It liquefies the prey, and then they slurp it back up, and then they regurgitate that vomit into the offspring's into their offspring's mouths, like a mother bird, right? Then later on in development, the young will co-feed with their mother. And then lastly, because there's synchronized generations here, all the females mature at the same time, the females will, towards the end of their lives, liquefy their own bodies via programmed cell death, and then their offspring will rip them apart and consume them. And we've actually shown just recently that the decomposition process actually starts pretty early on in this parent-offspring relationship. So the females are actually liquefying their own bodies and then vomiting up components of their own viscera when they're regurgitating the prey as well. So there's that. And it's generally believed that these are foraging societies. So it's the ability to subdue larger and more profitable prey size classes that imbue these societies the benefit that allows sociality to evolve. And they're highly inbred. So the spider that we're gonna talk about today, the relatedness coefficient across pairs of individuals inside the societies are between 0.75 and 0.98, depending on the colony and the population. Ooh, sure. Yeah. Yeah, well, they all basically, they have a senescent period, and so The species that we're going to talk about today only lives 1 year, and it has a wet, dry season, and the females perish just before the dry season. So they're probably, you know, if you look at their subsocial relatives, they complete one generation per year, and so it's not that shocking. The social species in South America complete 3 generations per year, and it's not in association with a wet or dry season there. But, you know, it might be that just, you know, their ancestors had a similar longevity, or it might be that they truncate their lives at a specific time point so that they can imbue their offspring with a critical resource at some key point in their development. No one really knows. But good idea, good question. Here. Yeah, so there are 19 to 21 independent origins of sociality for all of these social spiders, and these traits are shared by all of them. Yeah, that's ancestral. Yeah, that's right. So that occurs in all spiders, including like tarantulas and things, really basal lineages. So that's external digestion is shared by all spiders. It's not a trick for these species. Cool. All right. So our spider for today is Stegodyphus demicola, which is a spider that occurs in southern and southwestern Africa. It's endemic to the Kalahari and Namib deserts and adjacent savanna habitats. So social spiders aren't like colonies of ants. They don't have like queens and soldiers and nurses and, you know, worker polymorphisms. Instead, individuals, if you just look at them, basically all look alike. These are painted individuals, but if I didn't paint them, you'd basically say these things are all equivalent. But that's actually not true. If you evaluate the behavioral tendencies of each one of these constituents, there's actually a lot of variability in how these individuals interact with their environment, their little personality types. The personality type that we're going to talk about today is boldness. So just the willingness of an individual to place itself at risk or put itself in a risky situation for whatever reason. The vast majority of individuals inside these societies are shy. They avoid risk. Anywhere between 1 and 5% of individuals, though, are bold. Some are just slightly bolder than everybody else, and some are way bolder than everybody else. And although this phenotype is a rarity inside of the societies, these bold individuals are an incredibly important feature. If you add just one bold individual to a colony of all shy individuals, it'll increase the number of attackers that respond to prey by 400%. It'll increase the number of web builders that come out each night by 250%. And in feather-bedded conditions in the laboratory where we just give them food ad libitum, they can increase the amount of collective mass gain of the whole society by 200%. So here, the collective behavior and perhaps the performance of groups could be determined by the traits or phenotypes of one or two oddball individuals inside of your social group. And so I should also note that these bold individuals act as colony elites. So if you establish an experimental colony at a new site, for a little while, the bold individual is the first individual to come out to capture prey. It's the first one to come out and repair the web each night. And that means they're the first individuals to acquire information about new sites. Oh, yeah, so the intra-class correlation coefficient. So that's like the estimate of repeatability. How do we determine how bold a spider is? We scare it. So these spiders can't see all that well, so when they feel directional puffs of air, this elicits a death feign response, and so they draw on their legs and they huddle up on a little death feign for a variable amount of time. The way we get them to assume that posture is using an infant nose cleaning bulb to puff some air at them, and so we then record how long individuals stay in this position. Bold individuals pop out quite quickly. Shy individuals can be in that state for 10 minutes, 20 minutes, 30 minutes, several hours, et cetera, et cetera. So bold individuals, as I sort of hinted at earlier, are a kind of keystone individual, which I define as an individual that just exhibits an inordinately large influence over the collective behavior and or success of their society. And so you might think, you know, like with human societies, we have a notion of how this might work, or maybe pigtail macaques or something, you might know how this works. But actually, keystone individuals occur in a variety of different kinds of societies. We actually did a literature review a few years ago and found more than 84, 85 different case studies of instances where one or a few individuals could change the behavior and success of their groups. So it's a relatively general phenomenon. Keystone individuals aren't always good, right? So sometimes these individuals have positive effects, and sometimes they have negative effects. Examples of like knowledgeable matriarchs or tutors might be instances where keystone individuals have positive effects on the collective performance of their society. But hyperaggressive individuals inside of water striders, which are just sort of males that attempt to mate with basically everything all the time very aggressively, actually end up frightening all of the females off of the water surface, which sterilizes the focal male. He gets no matings, and then frightens all the females away from all the other males as well. So one hyperaggressive male inside of a copulatory swarm of these insects actually results in decreased elimination, temporary elimination, of mating for all of the constituents of the group. Super spreaders are a fine example of an individual that perhaps because of their traits could have a large influence over the dynamics of a society, but those aren't good, those are a liability. And so my favorite element about these individuals is that their effects can vary dynamically as well. So the same individuals that could help you under one set of circumstances could potentially screw you in another set of circumstances. And that's the jumping off point of our talk today. So, sure. I don't know. My normal way that I would try to approach one of these topics is like, you know, whether or not you even have Keystone individuals is to do a reciprocal addition removal experiment of almost every constituent in groups, and then see what effects these removals and additions have on some response variable, collective foraging behavior, anti-predator behavior, short-term effects on group success. And then I would say, you know, if you get this sort of skewed distribution where a small number of individuals have a large effect on the collective outcomes, then I would try to figure out what traits are about those individuals, or can we even predict what the traits are about those individuals that put them on that side of the distribution. But I think almost all the examples that we summarized in this animal behavior review were basically anecdotes, just saying, you know, we saw this one individual, it was behaving like this, and it went into a trash heap and ate a bunch of trash and got bovine tuberculosis and then wandered back and gave it to everybody else, right? And so actually, most of this literature is almost, and this is gonna sound really derogatory, I don't mean it to be, almost like an anecdotal pseudoscience or something like you just sort of say as a natural history note at the end of your paper, or could actually be the focal point of your behavior. But actually, the sort of novelty of this is that we are trying to be as interventionalist as possible and really get at this in a direct manner, which actually I think evades some systems. It's not tenable in some systems, but maybe in the future we can try to unite both approaches. So let's pretend for a moment, though, that on average, Keystone individuals are a good thing, right? Because they're around still now, right? How costly could they be in an evolutionary sense? Well, even if they're a good thing, it's still a liability, in my view, for a couple of reasons. One, what happens if this Keystone individual just dies? Or they leave you? Are you just thwarted now? Or what happens if these individuals are tutors or these elite individuals, if they acquire misinformation? What happens when accurate information or inaccurate information is obtained by these Keystone individuals and potentially distributed to other members of the society? And then if you're an enemy, say a parasite or disease or a social parasite or an inquiline, could you manipulate the whole phenotype of a society by identifying and manipulate the behaviors of one or a few key individuals? For our talk today, we're gonna talk about these first two topics, and then my student who just got a job at the University of Florida addresses this last topic. So, what happens if your Keystone just disappears? Are there mechanisms of robustness? Do you see effects that persist after the disappearance of these Keystone individuals? Do they have legacy effects? Prediction one is that the effects of Keystone individuals will linger after their departure. If they're beneficial, if they imbue advantageous collective phenotypes, then after their disappearance, there should be some mechanism that allows those advantages to persist for at least a little while, possibly until a new Keystone individual emerges or something like that. And then secondarily, that these legacy effects, how long we can detect the influence of these key individuals, should scale to how long the individuals were in the group to begin with. An influential individual that's around a group for a long time should have a longer lasting effect. It had a greater opportunity to manipulate the phenotype of its society, and those effects should persist through time. So for this, we create experimental colonies on day negative 20. On day negative 20, we take 19 shy individuals, and then on day negative 20, negative 10, or negative 5, we add a bold individual that's either slightly bolder than everybody else or way bolder than everybody else in a continuous distribution. And then on day 0, we remove all of the Keystone individuals. Then after that, we look at the number of attackers that respond to prey for 1, 3, 6, 12, and 24 days after the Keystone's removal. And then we see for how long after the Keystone's gone can we detect an association between the personality type of that Keystone individual that was and the collective behavior of the society. For our controls, on day negative 20, we add 18 shy individuals and one bold individual, and then on day negative 20, 10, 5, we add just some shy generic Joe Schmo, and then on day 0, we remove Joe Schmo and then see whether or not there's any effect of just adding and removing individuals. Copacetic, cool. Oh, nope. Oh, no, only one. Sorry. Nope, that's a typo. I've given this talk like 20 times. Thank you for saying that. I'll remember this now. Maybe I will. All right, so we're looking at the days since Keystone's removal on the x-axis here, and we're going to look at colonies that either had the Keystone in there for 5 days, 10 days, or 20 days. The y-axis is the correlation coefficient between the personality type of that Keystone individual and the average number of attackers that come out to attack prey. And so as long as this value is positive, that means we can still detect an association between the personality type of the Keystone and the collective behavior of their society, even after the Keystone's removal, however many days after removal. And then as soon as those confidence intervals overlap zero, it means we can no longer detect a significant association there. And so here are the data, and there's a couple things I want you to get out of this. Number one is that for all durations, whether the Keystone was in there for 5 days or 10 days, for at least a few days after their departure, there's still an association between the personality type of that Keystone individual and the collective behavior of their social group. So they have legacy effects that persist after they're gone, which suggests they have some sort of at least semi-stable influence on the behavior of other group members after their departure. And then for instances where the Keystones are in there for quite a while, say 20 days, that effect actually persists for up to 24 days after the Keystone's departure. And 24 days is significant for a couple of reasons. Because one, now the Keystone has been gone for longer than it was ever in there to begin with. And so in order to understand how a society is behaving, you can't just know its current composition. You can't just know its current environment. You have to understand where it came from and who was in it before. I think that's pretty shocking. And then secondarily, you might say 24 days, who cares about this? But these individuals are only mature for about 90 days. So that actually is a significant component of their lives. And then if you just remove some generic Joe Schmo, not shockingly, there's still a very tight association between the collective behavior of the society and the personality type of these Keystone individuals. So the Keystone individuals are still there, so there's still a very tight association. So do the effects of Keystone individuals persist, linger after their departure? Yes. Do they scale to the duration that those individuals were ever in there to begin with? A little bit. I mean, it's not as nice as I would have liked, but at least coarsely, yes. The instances where the Keystones were in there for 20 days, we see that those legacy effects persist for quite a long time after their departure. So there's that. So what happens, though, if these Keystone individuals, which are the first to interact with a novel environment, the first to capture prey, the first to interact with predators, et cetera, acquire good information or bad information? And by good information and bad information, I mean accurate and inaccurate information. And so the prediction is that both good information and bad information will have its greatest effects when it's in the hands of a Keystone individual, right? You're socially influential, which means if you have a good strategy, it should help us a lot. It should help our society soar. And then if you have bad information, it means that maybe we won't do so well, right? Relative to the equivalent information in the hands of just some schmo individual, right? So, and the problem is if you go out into nature, this is just value neutral at this point. This is just that the last third of this talk will determine whether or not these are advantageous or not in situ. Excellent question. Hopefully we'll satiate that in just a small number of slides. Sure.
Mm. Showing that the Keystones are influencing the behavior when they get added in.
Yes.
And do you also see that?
Yeah, there's a duration where I mentioned that when Keystone individuals are the first ones to come out to attack prey and things like that, there's actually no association during those first few days between the personality type of a Keystone individual and the collective behavior of the group. That it takes a number of days before we see a pattern that emerges, an association that emerges between the Keystone's personality type and the collective behavior of the whole society. And it usually takes about 4 or 5 days, and then oftentimes that's when we see a decrease in the direct involvement of Keystone individuals that sort of resemble the behavior of any generic individual inside the society. So there's a latency period before the effect emerges, and it's not when the Keystone individual is the only one doing everything. All right, so in real life, it's hard to tell what a spider knows and doesn't know in nature and what information it has, so we just trained a bunch of spiders with accurate or inaccurate information. So we trained individual spiders with either Keystone individuals or generic shy individuals to learn one of two novel vibratory stimuli, if I say vibration A, to learn to associate it with a prey item, and vibration B with a predator, or vice versa. It was alternated among individuals. There are control individuals that receive an identical number of interactions between vibration A and B, but they are not consistently paired with either outcome. So sometimes vibration A is a predator, sometimes it's a prey, et cetera, et cetera. So it's a yoke control. We then create experimental societies of 9 naive spiders that have never interacted with one of these novel vibratory stimuli, because they don't share an evolutionary history with a vibrator. And then we add one trained individual that either has accurate or inaccurate information. And so how we create that is we either have colonies interacting with an environment that matches the training of these seed individuals, whether they're keystones or not, or mismatches. We undergo a reversal so that their training is actually at odds with the new environment. And so we see how long it takes for the whole society to wise up and realize that this novel vibratory stimulus is a prey item, and this one is a predator. So how do we actually let them associate a predator and prey? We give them, for a prey item, we give them a karoo moth, which is just one of the most common and small prey items in nature. We give them a small prey item because we need to keep motivation to forage up high, otherwise they just won't keep responding. And then they always like to avoid their most dangerous predators, so for the predator treatment, we touch individuals that respond with a pugnacious ant, Anapalepis custodians, which is responsible for the collapse of about 40% of the societies in nature, and they rip up the spiders en masse and take them away on foraging trails. So these really are quite dangerous predators, and the spiders are aware of it. So, can I train spiders? These are just gonna be learning curves, and these aren't the most beautiful learning curves because I think there are some issues with motivation, but we're looking at the trial number on the x-axis, the latency to attack along the y, for generic individuals in dark green, keystone individuals in light green, and this is just gonna be for the rewarding stimulus, and if these spiders are learning that this is a rewarding stimulus, we should see the average latency attack to going down, right? And then we'll see the controls up simultaneously. And so, consistent with our predictions that we're training these spiders effectively, we do see latency to attack on average going down. We see this weird blip here, which I'm told is probably associated with motivation to forage. Maybe they were full on that day or something like that. But on average, the latency to attack is going down through time, and it's different from the control individuals. If you pair a novel vibratory stimulus A or B with the predator, it's a much more compelling pattern. The spiders are quite good at learning both keystones and generics to avoid, or at least respond more slowly, to their most dangerous predator. And if I remove those pesky controls, you can see that latency to attack goes down when stimuli are paired with a reward, and latency to attack goes up when the stimuli are paired with the most dangerous predator, wowie zowie. That was the precondition for this whole thing, so we're glad we could do that. All right, so now, how long it takes to attack a prey item. So once that vibratory stimulus is in the web, how long does it take for the individual to emerge from its nest and go over and attack it? This is not a real prey item in this instance, it's just a vibrator. All right, so are there consequences of having informed or misinformed individuals inside of a society, and do they change based on whether or not this information or misinformation is in the hands of a keystone individual or some generic? First, we're just gonna look at the rewarding stimulus. We've got the trial number along the x-axis, the y-axis is the latency to attack of the whole society, and informed individuals, whether they're misinformed or informed, if they're generic, will be in red. If they're keystones, they'll be in this sort of like fuchsia purplish color. And then misinformation will be in the right-hand panel, and correct information will be on the left-hand panel. So with accurate information, it doesn't matter whether informed individuals are generic individuals or keystone individuals. Societies, if they just have one informed individual, learn more quickly to attack this novel vibratory stimulus and respond to it more quickly, right? So having one informed individual, regardless of whether or not it's your influential keystone or not, doesn't really matter. It means the whole society learns more quickly to attack a novel resource. Now, if you have misinformation, it's a very different sort of outcome. Misinformation, there is no significant effect of having misinformation in the hands of a generic Joe Schmo. But if you have misinformation in the hands of your keystone individual, then you see that these societies attack those profitable prey stimuli much more slowly. And that's important because these moths, once they interact in the webs in real life, they don't just stick around for forever. These are time-sensitive opportunities, right? The moth doesn't want to die. And so after a few seconds, this thing oftentimes just gets away. And so if you have a misinformed keystone individual, and that's slowing the rate with which your whole society responds, then it means that will be missed foraging opportunities for your whole society. So misinformation in the hands of a generic individual, not a problem. Misinformation in the hands of a keystone individual, major problem, potentially. What about the dangerous stimulus? The same axes as before, same panels as before. If you have correct information, accurate information, in the hands of a generic or keystone, does not matter. All societies are very good at learning to avoid their most dangerous predator. What do you know? However, if you have misinformation, you get an ephemeral but notable response. And that is misinformation in the hands of a keystone individual for a small number of trials results in the whole society running out to capture its most dangerous predator. It's only for a small number of trials, but it doesn't take a whole lot of dangerous encounters to get everyone killed, right? And so we don't allow these spiders in these trials to be eviscerated by the ants because it takes a long time to train these spiders, and we need to keep them alive for as long as possible. But in real life, this could be quite costly, right? So maybe in feather-bedded conditions in laboratory, it's good to have these keystone individuals because there were no enemies. But once there are enemies about, or dynamic environments where the prey identity changes through time, these keystone individuals have the potential to become a liability. So are there fitness consequences of keystone individuals? We don't really have, for this study, excellent examples of fitness, but we do have one proxy, and that is that we masked all of the spiders to begin with, and then we masked them all again at the end, and we see how much does the mass change of the whole society. So along the y-axis here, we have the average change in mass of the average colony constituent, and along the x-axis, we have controls, informed generics, misinformed generics, informed keystones, and misinformed keystones. Two things I want you to get out of this graph. Number one is no one's really ever gaining all that much mass, and that's because we're basically keeping these whole societies hungry to keep them motivated to forage. But if you have a misinformed keystone individual, you're actually significantly losing mass. So having one misinformed individual, if it's your socially influential individual, results in the whole society withering. And if you look at their abdomens, they look like little shriveled up raisins. It was very apparent halfway through the study that this was transpiring. And so this is just some distributions to fortify that intuition. So here's some depressing things. If you're somebody who studies animal communication, you're oftentimes you think, oh, communication's great, that information's important, it's gonna have all these consequences. Here, not so much. Correct information, accurate information, has no significant effect. Information only really seems to have an effect, at least in these contrived scenarios, if it's misinformation and it's in the hands of influential individuals. You mean CNN? CNN fake news? Yeah, no, I would be concerned about that too. I'll flirt with that notion in just a moment. So the summary, so misinformed keystones can slow the collective learning of a whole society about its novel environment. Misinformed keystones can reduce the collective weight gain of the societies, yet informed individuals, regardless of identity, seem to have no effect. And so that means that these keystone individuals, at least under these dynamic conditions, could be a liability. They can't help you with good information, but they can hurt you with bad information. And that means that they're sort of ratcheting you for susceptibility in dynamic conditions. But at least under laboratory and in stable conditions, we see that they have a positive effect. So what about a solution? What happens if you just kill the keystone, you remove the keystone, you allow some sort of successional event to transpire, right? Works inside of human societies, why not? Why don't you determine, we've actually been able to show in this study and in a theoretical analysis that these keystone individuals, in terms of their legacy effects, those elements of misinformation, those persist after their departure as well. So they're transmitting misinformation across individuals that persists after their departure, and those two scale based on how long the individuals were ever inside of a society. Which means that each and every day that your society endures the ill effects of a problematic keystone individual is yet another day that it screws you even after it's gone. And we have a notion of how this might work inside of human societies and, you know, possibly primate societies, but the cool thing about systems like these is that you can actually look at those temporal dynamics in a sophisticated, orthogonally manipulated way to look at cause-effect relationships in a way that elude a lot of data sets. And if you have ideas on this topic, I mean, we are only limited by our own imagination. I know that data might be an anti-aphrodisiac for many of you, but if you have a cool idea, we can evaluate it, and I would be excited to collaborate with you. So, what are the effects of keystone individuals in situ? We said that under stable conditions in laboratory, they're good. We said, you know, in these very contrived situations with misinformation, they're bad. But in real life, what are they doing for colony performance in the wild? And so for this, we have two predictions. One, the boldness of the single boldest member of the group will be a major driver of the collective foraging aggressiveness of a society. It's been true all along. We're hoping it's true here as well. And then secondarily, more aggressive societies should do better at arid sites, which are resource depauperate, right? There's fewer opportunities to forage for prey, so you better attack those prey rapidly in aggregate. So in that case, it should be beneficial to have a keystone individual. At wet sites, adjacent to savanna habitats, there are more foraging opportunities, but there are also more enemies, right? And so under those conditions, we think that it could be costly to have a keystone individual. So put in another way, you could say that we're looking to evaluate whether or not the rise and fall of societies could be contingent on the traits of one or a few extreme individuals, and whether or not those effects vary dynamically across different situations. And so how do we do this? We engineer experimental societies with 19 shy individuals and one bold individual that's either slightly bolder than everybody else or way bolder than everybody else. We then assay the collective behavior of the whole society, and we deploy 30 colonies per site along two orthogonal precipitation gradients, one from the Namib Desert heading north and one from the Kalahari Desert heading east towards Lesotho. And then we monitor colony survival for 2 months in the field. And I should say that we checked each of these colonies every 2 weeks, which involved driving about 25,000 miles over the course of 5 months last year. And that's a little more than the circumference of planet Earth. All right. And then we see whether or not colonies live or die. All right, so is group success determined by the phenotype of one or a few extreme individuals at arid sites? The x-axis will be the boldness of the single boldest member of the group. The y-axis will be the average number of attackers. I don't actually want you to be able to tell apart these different sites. They don't really matter. If they're open circles, it means the colony died. And by the way, if a colony dies, I mean no one is left. If there was one spider left alive inside the society, the colony is still alive. If everyone is gone, it's dead. And each and every year, between 60 and 90% of naturally occurring colonies go extinct. Nobody survives, nobody escapes, death, 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 little spider carcasses blowing in the wind. So two things here. One, the collective aggressiveness of the society is positively associated with the boldness of the single most bold individual in the group. That's good. These individuals did that in lots of other cases. We're glad that it was robust in this environment. And then secondarily, it's only societies that occur in this upper right-hand corner here that have a bold keystone and behave aggressively that persist through time. So at arid sites, it really is the whole colony, its fate is determined, at least to some degree, by the phenotypes of one or a few extreme group members. How about at wet sites? There are a couple of problems. Same axes, different sites, two problems. One, there is no association between how the group behaves in terms of its foraging aggressiveness and the traits of those extreme individuals. So those bold individuals that I've been harping on this whole time as being keystone individuals, at wet sites, they don't seem to matter. Secondarily, whether or not they did matter, there's no association between how aggressively a whole society forages and whether or not they live or die. And this is problematic because this was the presupposition that underlied two different grant proposals. And so this thwarts a lot of notions. All right, so a recap thus far. How group composition maps to the collective behavior of a society varies across different sites, which suggests that either the rules that assemble collective phenotypes might vary across sites as a consequence of local adaptation, or maybe history, or maybe they're situational. That's an interesting notion. Secondarily, there's site-specific selection on colony aggressiveness. So it's good to occupy a more aggressive society under prey-limited, resource-limited conditions, but at a wet site, there's no benefit or cost to having a more aggressive society. And if you look at naturally occurring colonies at arid sites, they're slightly more aggressive than colonies at wet sites, so it's possibly locally adapted. So these are like preliminary recaps. The problem is that the social influence of these bold individuals varied by site. At arid sites, they were really influential. At wet sites, not so much. And so the question is, what is it about these bold individuals at arid sites that makes them so special, that makes them so influential? Can we determine that phenotype? What makes a great animal leader? But let's have a philosophical pause for a moment, because that is a question that everyone, I'm going to say 60% to 70% of papers transfix on in the animal leadership literature. What creates an influential leader? But there's another problem here. So you could ask yourself, what makes a socially influential individual here? What allows him to be so magnetic? Why are we drawn to him? Why do we follow all of his tweets? But then there's a second phenotype, at least, that's quieter, and is probably also important as well, and that is, what is wrong with everybody else in this picture, right? Why are you drawn to these phenotypes? So in order to get a leader individual to emerge, you have to maybe have a leader phenotype, but then you have to have a follower phenotype as well, potentially. And the fact that we have the same kinds of individuals, apparently, that are leaders at some sites, but not elsewhere, allows us to manipulate those groups to figure out to what degree is leadership a consequence of the traits of socially influential individuals versus the population majority's willingness to follow. And that's our last topic for today. So what do? We create chimeric societies of 19 shy individuals and one bold individual, and we take bold individuals from arid sites where they're influential, and we pair them with we put them in a population of shy individuals from wet sites where they ain't following anybody. Then we take bold individuals from wet sites where nobody cares about them, evidently, and we pair them with shy individuals from arid sites where they are used to responding to bold individuals. And then we assay the collective behavior of the groups to try to figure out what is the key ingredient here, or is it some combination of matching of phenotypes. So can bold individuals from arid sites drive the social dynamics that we see over and over again in these shy follower individuals from wet sites? The answer is no. So if you look at that association between the boldness of the Keystone individual and the aggressiveness of the whole society, that is flat, flat, flat. Right? So these bold individuals, if you put them with another population majority, nobody responds to them, at least not significantly so. So will shy individuals from an arid site follow a bold individual from anywhere? A bold individual from their site or a different site? Can a bold individual just be a bold individual? Leaders are everywhere. The answer is yes. Shy individuals from arid sites will follow a bold individual from anywhere, and to the same degree, they would follow a bold colony member, right? So it's social susceptibility that drives the leader-follower, Keystone generic dynamic that we see at arid sites, but not elsewhere. Different combinations of wet and arid sites. So we have one wet site and one arid site per transect. So one from the Namib and towards Angola, and one from the Kalahari over towards Lesotho. That becomes relevant at one of the last scatter plots that I'm basically just going to gloss right over, but you'll see in a second. All right, so what about a bold heterospecific? So here's Stegodyphus mimosaurum, which is independently evolved sociality and last shared a common ancestor with Stegodyphus dimicola 2.1 to 2.5 million years ago. And that ancestor was not social. So in this society, individuals also differ temporally and consistently in their boldness, and we use the exact same test. So the question is, will a bold heterospecific be sufficient to beget followership or social responsiveness in the population majority for arid individuals? So will shy individuals from arid sites follow a bold heterospecific where they do not share an evolutionary history, at least in terms of a social context? The answer is absolutely they will. I mean, those spiders basically look identical if I put them next to you on the table, but they are different species and they've independently evolved sociality and the phylogeny is very well resolved. But a bold heterospecific will beget followership to the same degree. Will shy individuals from wet sites follow them? The answer is no. So one of these lines is flat, and then one of these is significantly negative. So if you have shy individuals from wet sites and you have a bolder heterospecific, it actually causes the whole society to be less aggressive, but it only happened with one combination of sites. We could talk about why that is, and we could talk about it for forever, but it's only one combination of sites, and so I don't put a lot of weight on that extremity. All right, so to recap, it's social susceptibility at arid sites that allows that leader-follower, Keystone-individual dynamic to emerge. The traits for animal leadership, the traits to be this catalytic individual, are present at every site. The fact that they're influential at some sites is all driven by the population majority's willingness to follow. And site-specific selection, oh, go ahead. Yeah. Well, we know that if you take all those shy individuals, and this is one of the bugaboos about personality, and that it makes it a really weird literature, and slippery. So if you look at all those shy individuals that were formerly all completely shy, some of these individuals become slightly bolder in the presence of a very bold Keystone individual, but those differences don't persist through time. And the majority of them resume a shy behavioral tendency later on. So it suggests that bold individuals are able to catalyze slightly bolder and more aggressive foraging tendencies in other individuals that persist after the Keystone's removal, and then they decay through time. But it could also be social learning. But yeah. So if you're just, you could just be slightly more aggressive, and that makes you more responsive to prey, even after their departure. So you might call that learning. It could just be that you were just around some other individual that just bumped into you enough times and agitated you enough that you are now, I mean, I guess if you could define learning broadly enough, that's also learning, but I feel afraid of saying, calling it social learning. Although, you know, something like culture, social learning, transmission, there is at least some suggestion that that's occurring, because when we remove these Keystone individuals, even misinformation persists, and if you take apart those whole societies and evaluate what each individual knows, whether or not to attack a prey item and avoid a predator, and actually we do find a higher instances of individuals learning whatever the association the Keystone had previously learned, but the reviewers did not like that, and so that has never actually been published in a paper. So that was going to be put as a supplementary, at first inside the main document and then a supplementary document, but it remains unpublished to date. But there's some suggestion that there's social learning transpiring. But people would not be ready, people are not likely to give that a charitable review if there's any hole to poke in it when it's a spider. So it's social susceptibility that causes the leader-follower dynamics to occur at arid sites, but not elsewhere. And there's site-specific selection on colony aggressiveness, right? So it's good to be an aggressive society at arid sites, but not wet sites, right? And the way that you're able to be in a more aggressive society is because the population majority is willing to follow, right? So it's advantageous for those societies in those circumstances. So it's good to be a more aggressive society, and social susceptibility or responsiveness is what enables you to have that collective phenotype there. So pretty much all of biology, probably a great deal of science in general, is trying to take complex collective phenotypes, level of social groups, communities, ecosystems, brains, whatever, and try to decompose those complex systems into constituent parts to characterize the attributes about those parts so that we can understand how they interact, how they assemble, how they're organized to beget emergent dynamics at higher levels of organization, right? Many of you, maybe all of you, are interested in such notions. And what I hope to have convinced you today is that we understand to some degree how at least a small number of collective phenotypes are created in these systems. We can decompose these societies into their constituent members. We can characterize them using a small number of behavioral assays and then reassemble them in a way to engineer the collective phenotypes of groups for brittleness or robustness based on our will, right? Based on our whims. We can engineer them, so much so that we can take independently evolved societies and mix and match the constituents, mix and match the parts to create the phenotypes we would like to have. And that at least suggests that a couple of things. One, we at least have some clue of what's going on for some traits sometimes, and that feels good, right? We're not all just stamp collecting. And then secondarily, that there's a limited number of ways to assemble a society, right? That there might be generalizable principles that we're trying to elucidate, and that isn't always the case. That isn't always reassured once evidence is brought to bear on it. And at least in this one circumstance, I think that might be the case, at least for a small number of phenotypes. So what makes an animal leader? What makes a socially influential individual? What makes these matriarchs, these tutors, these leaders, what have you. And I think that question is a little bit of a trap and might be our own evolutionary history as socially susceptible, socially responsive beings that we then just sort of project on the rest of the animal world and say, you know, we are susceptible, so, and we know that something about those other individuals that makes us follow them, so we're gonna try to find that such patterns in other kinds of societies, but I think that might be a trap. Because, you know, at least here, and perhaps in a lot of other systems, there can't be a leader without a socially susceptible population. But in the hands of the truly socially susceptible, anything even coarsely approximating the phenotype of a leader, even a heterospecific sham, will do the trick. And isn't that disheartening? And with that, I'd like to acknowledge Noah Pinterwoman from UCLA, a bunch of people who has helped me collect all those data. These people drove thousands and thousands of miles with me, the Bionational Science Foundation with Israel, the National Science Foundation Integrative Organismal Systems Cluster, the National Institute of Health, and then finally, a suite of collaborators, consultants, and friends here and all over the world that remind me that science is a dialogue, and thankfully, none of us have to be in it alone. And thank you very much for listening and having me.